Hey, Foundry Church, welcome to worship today. As we get going, we're diving into Luke chapter 8, and we're really wrestling with the idea of the right response. I remember this when I was back in my college days in England. I didn't go to school in England. I actually went to my discipleship training school, which was through Youth with a Mission back there. So I wasn't in college over there, but when I was there, me and my buddy John Midyard, he's this awesome guy. He's from the Faroe Islands, like way up in like, you know, Viking country. And he and I loved to scare people. I love to scare people. I love to watch people jump out of their skin. I think it's hilarious until they scare me and I punch them in the throat, which is always unfortunate, but it's a fight or flight issue. So what we had in this situation was my buddy John decided to scare this guy named Adrian, and he hid in a dark nook. And when Adrian jumped by, John didn't scream. He didn't yell. He had a long sleeve t-shirt with the sleeves hanging off his head. And he just kind of came out of the dark corner like Swamp Thing. And Adrian let out a roar that only could communicate one thing. He accepted that death had come. He was just like, and then out of it was like, and it just lasted so long that you're like, stop screaming. It was amazing. It was awesome. He didn't speak to us for like 2 days, which I love. I thought it was amazing because his response was one of just sheer terror, which was our goal. But I think when we look at responses, we know that we have this reptilian brain that when we go into our reptile or animal brain, we go into fight or flight. We go into survival mode. When we're up here in kind of the frontal cortex, we're living in a logical, more reasonable state. And Jesus Christ puts, or people are engaging Jesus Christ in various places in their life. Moments of panic, moments of suffering, and dealing with things for a long time. And Jesus encounters them, and we begin to see their response to him. Today we start out with the parable of the sower. It's a well-known scripture out of Luke chapter 8. It's how the chapter begins. Follow along with me as I read. It says this: after this, Jesus traveled about from town to town and from one village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12, the disciples, were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had been cast out, Joanna, the wife of Chuza, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. So they were paying to support Christ and his disciples in ministry. While a large crowd was gathering and people were coming to Jesus from town after town, he told them this parable. A farmer went out to sow his seed. I am not a farmer. If you know me, don't let the flannel deceive you. I can barely grow fingernails, much less like a plant, right? I'm not a farmer, but I do know this. When you sow seed, it just means it was planting season. They were planting seed in the ground. It says, a farmer went out to sow seed, and as he was scattering the seed, so he goes out and he takes the seed and he's scattering it in a handful out into the field. Some of it fell along the path. It was trampled on and the birds ate it up. Some of the seed fell on rocky ground, and when it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up with it and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil. When it came up, it yielded a crop 100 times more than was planted. When he said this, he called out to the crowd, whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. Let them hear what the Spirit's saying. The disciples asked him what this parable meant, and he said to them, the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to others I speak in parables, so that though seeing, they may not see, though hearing, they may not understand. Jesus goes on to say, this is the meaning of the parable you just heard. The seed is the word of God. Those along the path are the ones who hear, and the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and not be saved. Those on the rocky ground are the ones who receive the word with joy, and when they hear it but have no root, they believe for a while, but in the time of testing, they fall away. And the seed that fell among the thorns stands for the worries, riches, and pleasures, and they do not mature. But the seed in good soil stands for those with a good and noble heart who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering, produce a crop. When we look at and understand this parable, we have different ways that we can apply it to our life. But there is a kind of a lineup of stories in Luke chapter 8 that I think we can actually use to apply immediately this story and interpret it through these next experiences. The responses of people to Jesus Christ. Jesus talks about four different types of soil, and we want to explore what these types of soil look like through some of the people he deals with. Some of the people who follow him, who come to him, who have need of him. You may have heard of these stories before, but today we're going to focus on some of the outside characters. Some people maybe on the fringes of the story, not the usual centerpiece characters that we normally attend to. The first one, when we talk about the seed that is sown along the path, I don't know about you, but growing up out west hiking, a lot of the soil was clay-like. And when you hike on it enough on the trails, it becomes as hard as concrete. And I know this, that in the rocky terrain of the Judean hillside where Jesus, or even the Galilean hillside where Jesus was teaching, the paths were well worn and they were pushed down and they were hard packed. And Jesus is talking about the seed that falls along the path. Really, this seed doesn't even make it into the soil. It bounces off the top of it. And the birds of the air, which is a direct reference to Satan, coming in and stealing the word of God from them hearing it and believing. But we have this story that I think is really interesting for us to grab onto and look at. It's the story of the demoniac in the Gerasenes. It comes out of Luke chapter 8, verses 26 to 38, I believe. And the story of the demoniac, and I'm going to tell it, you can go read the scripture, but here's the story, here's what happened. Jesus had said to his disciples, "Let's go across the lake, the Sea of Galilee." They take off across the lake. When they get to the Gerasenes, getting out of the boat, they are met by this demoniac. Let's paint a picture of him. Let's think about it. The dude is naked. He's got broken chains hanging off him. And he's howling and screaming and running around the tombs. I would get back in my boat and leave. Like, right? Wouldn't you? Who's going to be like, "Oh, great, you know, Daryl's here," right? That would be very uncomfortable. It would be horrifying to see this. This guy comes at them howling and screaming, "Jesus, Son of the Most High God, what do you want to do with us? Did you come here to torture us?" And Jesus tells the demons inside of him to silence, "Be quiet." And at the end of the story, where we find Jesus having cast the legion of demons out and him sitting there in his right mind, people see this happen. They go tell the town all comes out to see this demoniac, this guy who they had bound and chained and put under guard, sitting clothed and in his right mind. And they probably had to come up like, "How's he doing today?" Right? And they see him sitting there. And their response to God is devastating. It is devastating when we look at it. Because the message of hope that came via the life of this incredibly broken man was never heard by the people. They said to Jesus, "Please depart from us." They were afraid of him. They were afraid of his power. And they asked Jesus, "Please leave. Please leave." Even the demoniac who wanted to follow Jesus, he said, "No, you must stay and go tell the town about what God has done for you, because they didn't receive me." They are like the seed that fell on the hard soil. They are like the ones who never believed and never grabbed on. We can look at their lives and see what an amazing opportunity they had, but they didn't grab onto it. They never even let the story in. The next type of soil we see is the rocky ground. Jesus spoke of seed that fell on rocky ground. When we talk about the Middle East, the Judean hillside, any of it really, right along that Mediterranean coastline, it's so rocky. There is more rocks than dirt out there. It's just everywhere. And Jesus talks about it, and he refers to it as those who hear the word, so it gets in, but it never takes root. It never takes root into their lives. They receive it eagerly at first, and they seem to respond really well. Like when you say to your kids, hey, go clean your room. And they're like, okay. And 20 minutes later, you see them in the same room. And you're like, why didn't you clean your room? Well, I started to. That's what it's like. They don't have any follow through. They don't have any root. They receive the word of God eagerly. But when the time of testing comes, when their faith is tested, they wither because there is no root. There's no depth to their faith. And there's an example of this kind of soil right here in Luke chapter 8. When we look at it in Luke 8, 40 to 42, and then it splits, and the story continues in verse 49 to 56. It's the story of Jairus. He is a synagogue leader. He's someone who leads like what we would know as a church, but the religious house of worship in little communities. Jairus is a synagogue leader. His daughter is sick. This is the era before Tylenol, which basically up to like 50 years ago was the era before Tylenol. But I know, right? But we have this time where if you have a fever, it can kill you. There's no way to cut the fever or break the fever. And she had been sick for a while, and Jairus comes. And remember that reptilian brain? I want you to picture a wild-eyed dad with his only child on death's door. And the only hope is Jesus Christ. And he comes and grabs Jesus. And he's like, please come help my daughter. She's dying. He grabs Jesus. He's like, please. Jesus comes with him. Some things happen on the way there, but eventually somebody comes up to Jairus and Jesus en route, and they say, don't bother the teacher anymore. The girl is already dead. And you can almost feel the wind go out of Jairus' sail. Like, oh, the thing he feared most, his only child is gone. And he's in this moment of heartache, and Jesus says, don't worry. If you have faith, the girl will be made well. Jesus goes to the house, and there were mourners there, people gathering, mourning and weeping and wailing, and it was a cultural thing. And Jesus gets there, and he says, why are you mourning? Why are you crying? The girl is not dead. She is just asleep. She is just asleep. And I think this is an important reality, because when he says this, it tells us that the people there laughed at him. Jesus was saying something that was bigger than what they could believe. Jesus wasn't giving them what they expected, and it was bigger than what they could conceive of. How can she just be well? We know she's not breathing. She's dead. And Jesus says, the girl is not dead. She is just asleep. And their response was to laugh at him, almost to mock him. And Jesus walks in and reaches out his hand and says, little girl, rise. And up she sits. But here's what I want to be very clear. When tested to believe beyond what they could see, the people couldn't do it. The people at Jairus' house couldn't believe beyond what they could see. When the test came, they had no root. And for us, we look at it and we realize quite often that can be us. When a test comes, we're ready to throw in the towel and walk away. The next place we see this this soil image come rising up is when we look at the soil that is among the thorns, that part of the field where there is wild weeds and things growing. And I think this is probably one of the most applicable, at least in my life, where I can look at this third category of soil and know that this soil represents things that get a hold of me at times. And it's this: they hear the word, but as they go through life, when the worries, riches, and pleasures appear, they don't mature. We get distracted by good things and miss the best thing. We get distracted by the worries and cares of our own selves when we are called to worry and care about that which God loves. Remember the seek ye first the kingdom of God? That verse that calls us to seek the things that God loves, and in the end, all of it will be added to us. What is God saying? Don't get lost in the things of this life. Don't let these choke the life of Christ out of you. When the worries, riches, and pleasures of life appear, we don't mature. So here's the story in chapter 8, and it's a story where we can look at the disciples. Now picture with me the disciples. They have been doing ministry with Jesus. They will spend 3 years with him. They have seen unbelievable miracles. Like, if we saw this stuff, like, seriously, if Lisa saw, like, somebody came in with a sack lunch on Monday night and we fed everybody in church with it, and there were 5,000 people here, and then we took 12 baskets of leftovers somewhere, I think we'd all be like, that was amazing, right? We wouldn't just sit there and be like, oh, that's, you know, went to McDonald's. No, we'd be amazed. The disciples were witnesses to this. They had seen his power. But here's where we find the worries and the cares, the storms of this life getting a hold of the disciples. Here's what I find interesting. Jesus, remember when I said early on, he says to the disciples, let's go across the lake. This is right before they meet the demoniac. And the disciples, who are most of them were fishermen, they were familiar with this body of water and being on the water, they head out across the lake. Jesus falls asleep in the stern of the boat, which he just takes a nap. So they're rowing or sailing across, and a squall breaks out. A big storm comes up on the lake, and this small open, kind of open cavern boat starts to get swamped. The disciples think they're going to die. It's raining really hard, and it's crazy, and Jesus remains asleep. And they come up to him. They're like, Master, Master, don't you care that we're going to die? It's got a Chicago ring to it. Never again, right? But we won't tease Justin. All right. But you can hear the tone like, oh my goodness, don't you care? Don't you care what's about to happen? And Jesus sits up, and you can almost feel the exasperation. This sense like, how long have we walked together, done ministry together? You've seen me. You know that I care not only about your physical life, but your eternal life. Why are you letting this little storm completely unseat and choke out your faith? And Jesus rebukes the wind and the waves. The waves go quiet, and the disciples sit in quiet awe and wonder at this person who can silence wind and wave, who even the wind and waves obey him. How many of us try to walk with Jesus, but just like these disciples, we find ourselves facing the storm of life, and instead of turning to God, we turn to shake our fist at God. How could you? Why would you do that? Or we get caught up in a crisis, and we lose our faith over a temporary issue. We get caught in a temptation. The worries, the pleasures, the riches of this life choke out our faith. We have a short kind of attention span. We can be a bit of a spiritual goldfish, right? Who like sees you outside the tank, is like, oh, hey, and looks away and is like, oh, hey, it's like Dory. And we get that way. You know, we constantly forget the goodness and faithfulness of God, and we get distracted by crisis after crisis and moment after moment and storm after storm and pleasure. We get distracted. We get lost in what God's doing by the things of this life, and those are the thorns that literally put their hands around the throat of our faith and choke it out, because it's all we focus on. It's all we think about. Have you ever had a life experience where it's all you thought about? Maybe you've been in an airport and your flight just got delayed, and you're like, this is not happening to me. And you're going to get wherever you're going, and you lose all reasonable behavior to get what you want. And you kind of come unglued at people, and normally you're a nice, decent person, but you getting somewhere was more important than the fact that this poor person working at, I don't know, the Delta counter is already having a miserable day, and you're over there laying into them because the immediacy of what you're facing demands all attention, and there's no regard for your faith and how it should engage the situation. I know you and I are similar in this. I know we have short attention spans, and we can't let the storms of this life choke our faith to its knees. We have to let go of the worries, the storms, the pleasures, the riches. These things can't own us. We are rooted into the good soil, which is the last place we see Jesus talk about. And I love this. Because you think this poor farmer has spread so much seed and nothing's growing. Everything's dying. This is terrible. But then we get to the good soil, and where Jesus says that there's one type of soil and seed coming together where they not only retain the word, but they persevere and they produce a harvest. They produce a harvest. It's abundant. And when we look at this, we know that we have a hard time persevering, as what we just talked about, right? But what does persevere mean? It means persistence in doing something that is difficult or has delays in achieving success. It has delays in achieving success. I can tell you this, it is a lot easier to win the Super Bowl on Madden on your Xbox than it is in real life. It is a lot more difficult to grind out physically and live the life of an NFL football player than it is to create yourself on Madden, which you can do, and be the most amazing player in the world, win the Super Bowl, all the trophies. That comes pretty easy. It doesn't take much perseverance. And if it does, we need to talk. I don't know if we just need to talk, because that's not perseverance, right? That's super duper lazy. But perseverance is this thing that allows us to keep doing something despite difficulty and delays in achieving success. There will be delays in us achieving success in our faith at times, and we must persevere through the dry seasons, through the good seasons. We must persevere and look ahead. And here's a story of a woman who did that. This woman that we're about to talk about in Luke chapter 8, verses 43, I think right on to 48, is a story of the tenderness of Jesus Christ. But I want to look at her as one who persevered. In the Old Testament covenant, there would have been laws against people who were bleeding. If you were bleeding, it would have been described as unclean, and you would have been put outside of the community until the bleeding, the flow of blood ceased. And it was just part of God's law. This woman had been bleeding. She had bleeding for 12 years. She had been isolated outside of her regular everyday life. And can you imagine with me how broken and tired and exhausted she was? All the doctors had said, there's nothing we could do. She had tried everything. Nothing had worked. 12 years in, you and I, let's be honest, me, if I have a hangnail for 3 days, I'm ready to throw in the towel. This woman had been bleeding for 12 years outside of her community. She had been isolated and alone with no answers and no hope. Yet when Jairus came to Jesus and said, my daughter's sick, Jesus started on a footpath over to Jairus' house. And somewhere between that house and the first meeting of Jairus and Jesus was a woman who had been isolated for 12 years. And when Jesus passes by, she reaches out and she grabs his cloak. And instantly she's healed. Now for us, we need to understand, Jesus was in a crowd of people, and people were touching him and all around him. So when she touched him, she did something that would have been a huge violation of the law. It would have been legal trouble for her. She touched Jesus. She, having a flow of blood, touched Jesus, making him what? Unclean. Her contact with him made Jesus unclean. And what's happening to Jesus? Everybody else is touching him. So what'd she just do? She just polluted the whole community. That's what would have been legally the issue for her. She had just polluted the entire community. She had done wrong and harmed everybody in the process. And Jesus stops and he says, who touched me? And the disciples are like, there are so many people here. I don't know. I think this guy, they didn't really know. They didn't have an answer. They didn't have a way to answer it. Lord, there's everybody's touching you. And Jesus says, no, power went out from me. I felt it. Who touched me? And the woman, knowing she could no longer hide herself, she crawled forward on her hands and knees. It was me. She knows she's in so much trouble. And Jesus speaks a word over her life regarding her faith and perseverance, and that she is made well. And here's what I love. When the unclean touch Jesus, he doesn't become unclean. They get made well. When the unclean touch Jesus, it doesn't wreck him. It restores them. And when we look at this story, we have to know that her perseverance is what yielded the harvest. Her perseverance is the thing that allowed her faith and reaching out and taking the cloak of Jesus in the hope that maybe God would answer her prayers through him. When that happened, her perseverance paid off. And for you and I, we must persevere to be the fruitful, the abundant crop that Christ has sown into good soil. You and I are not called to make excuses of why we were planted in thorny soil, rocky soil, or along the footpath. No, we, the people of God, we are actually the good soil. But it takes work to stay in a place where we're not owned by the cares and worries of this life and the cares and worries of the storms, of the hard experiences that made us hardened like the footpath, of the shallow things like in the rocky soil that don't allow our faith to take root. We have to claim in our life that if the Word of God is planted into it, we will till and work the soil. We will participate with God on His terms for one reason, so that our life will have an abundant harvest, that people around us will come to know Christ, that we will be the ones who grow 30-fold. For every one of us planted, 30 more will come, 60 more will come, 100 more will come. If the church would live with a multiplied concept, that if we live a life not owned by the cares, worries, and different aspects of this life, we could actually be a fruitful example, a life-giving harvest of righteousness in this world to the world around us. So here's the deal. There is an effort to be made in preparing the soil of your life, but there's also an invitation. There is one who prepares us as only He can. I want to invite you to have God come and prepare the soil of your life. If you are owned by the cares of this life, if you have, like the disciples did when a time of testing came, there was no root, I want you to invite God to come and clear the field. Get the stones out of there. If there's hardened experiences that made you unlovable in your own mind and you're hardened and you have no kindness, no compassion, and the Word of God bounces off you like rain off a windshield, I want to invite you to ask God to come and turn the soil. To literally just turn it over and soften what was once hard. Invite God to come and prepare the soil of your life to do one thing, to create a harvest of righteousness for the glory of God in this age and the age to come. We are part of the great witness of the church over the last 2,000 years who have been people who've had the soil overturned. And they've been faithful witnesses to God in their life and the lives around them. That's the calling to us. How will we respond to God? The only way to respond well is to be prepared by the one who plants the seed. Invite God to come, soften you and prepare you to receive not only His very best, but to receive the high calling of those who are called to be fruitful, those who are called to be part of the great harvest of the kingdom of God. Pray with me. Lord Jesus Christ, thank You for Your word. Thank You that we're called to respond to You in ways that display our faith in living, active ways. God, I pray that we would see growth in our own lives, that if we face a storm or a crisis, that we wouldn't scream and wail and freak out, but we would take heart and grab onto You and trust in You. Lord, that we would persevere in times of trial. Lord, that we would be soft in areas where once we were hard-hearted and unkind and unloving. Lord, come to us, we pray, and meet us in the places where we most need You to prepare the soil of our lives. Because we know this, God, that You intend to grow the kingdom of God out of our lives, out of us giving a reflective witness to You. And that only comes by Your work, Your hand, and Your love. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.